My dear children, my dear sisters and brothers in Christ Jesus. One of the beautiful passages of the Gospel of St. John is this incident of the woman caught in adultery experiencing the loving forgiveness of Jesus. We are told all the people went to their respective homes one evening, and Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. Why did Jesus go to the Mount of Olives? You all know it was for him a place of prayer. Early in the morning, Jesus comes back to the temple to teach the people. Suddenly, Jesus is interrupted. What happened? The Pharisees bring a woman and place before Jesus amidst the crowd. You can experience, you can imagine what kind of humiliation for a woman to be brought there, who were mostly men there in the temple. And then why did they bring? The Gospel tells us that they wanted to test Jesus, that Jesus may say something and be trapped. They put a question before Jesus. Jesus, what do you say? They need not have brought her. They make use of that woman to achieve their end of persecuting Jesus, their end of accusing Jesus. That is their primary purpose. The Gospel clearly tells us they could have taken that woman to some other rabbi. They could have taken that woman to some other court, or they could have done what they wanted. But then they bring that woman precisely to trap Jesus, that Jesus may something. Jesus may say something and be caught. What is their question? Master, you always give good judgment. This woman is caught in the very act of adultery. Moses has given us a law that such persons should be stoned to death. What do you say? What do you say? That is the question that Jesus is confronted with. What do you say? They wanted to catch Jesus. Suppose Jesus says, okay, follow the law of Moses, means they will say Jesus is not at all compassionate. Suppose Jesus says, come on, let her free, then they will say Jesus does not obey the law of Moses. Both ways he is caught. Whatever is the answer Jesus gives, he is caught. We ask us a number of other questions, my dear brothers and sisters. What happened to the men or man who was caught with her? Or did the man escape? Why did they catch the man? Moses says both of them should be put to death. Why this woman alone is brought here? We are told that Jesus was writing on the floor. Maybe Jesus wanted them to realize what they are doing is not right. Jesus was writing. They did not leave him. They did not leave him. They said, come on, Master, tell us. They go on persisting with their question. And then now Jesus looks at them. We may receive wrong judgments from earthly courts, but Jesus knows everything. And Jesus speaks finally. Because they persisted in their questions. Let him who is without sin be the first to cast the stone at him. My dear brothers and sisters, we all need to examine ourselves. We all condemn like those Pharisees. We look at other people's mistakes. We don't use the mirror, we use the microscope to look at the mistakes of all others. But while we look at our own mistakes, Even huge marbles are looking very little for us, our own mistakes. That's what happens. The son is accused by the teacher, "What, your son is every day stealing something or other in the school. Every day he is stealing a pen. Can't you correct him?" Then the father of the family says, "He is stupid. I am stealing 10 pens every day from my office. Why he is stealing, I don't know." The same mistake which the father is doing, the son is doing at his own level. Jesus, during the Sermon on the Mount, beautifully told us, "There is a log in your own eye, but then you see the small speck in the eyes of others." Look at your own mistakes. Sometimes we find fault with all the others, even in the travel, in the road. All others are not violating the rules. All others are not obeying the rules, but while you yourself violate so many rules. Even in the family, when you do something, you are taking rest. When others are taking rest, they are lazy. When you are angry, you are fighting for justice. When others are angry, they are short-tempered. One measurement for ourselves, and then another measurement for others. We are very strict with others, very generous with ourselves. Very strict with others, but generous with ourselves. That's what Jesus says. You should have credibility to correct others. My dear brothers and sisters, do you have the credibility to cast a stone at this woman? They wanted to trap Jesus. Jesus is wiser than all these people. Remember this as the first lesson of today, my dear brothers and sisters. Examine yourself first. You know the famous incident of someone bringing her son to Mahatma Gandhi, telling he is eating so many sweets every day eating 20, 30 chocolates. So many, so much of sweet this boy is eating. "Gandhiji, you please correct him." And then he said, "It seems, madam, you go and come after 2 weeks. Then, after 2 weeks, Gandhiji told that little boy, "So don't eat too many chocolates. It is not good for your teeth. Later on, it is not good for your health also," he told his son. Then the mother of the boy asked, "Why did you ask me to come after 2 weeks? Then Gandhi said it seems, "I myself was eating too much of chocolate, too much of sweet. That's why." First, you have to correct yourself. Then only you can correct others. Don't condemn others, thinking that you are the innocent. Jesus only challenged the Pharisees, "Which one of you can convict me of sin?" He himself doesn't condemn others. How can you and I can condemn others? We think all the others are very wicked and we are the just ones. If at all one thing Jesus condemns, this kind of Pharisaic attitude, my dear brothers and sisters. Jesus said, "Yes, you can cast the stone, provided you are without sin." Then what happened, you know? Again he started writing. What did he write? Some of them are saying Jesus was writing their sins on the ground. What did he write? Then one by one they put the stone and then slowly disappeared. Starting from the eldest, it seems. The gospel says, starting from the eldest. The eldest went away first. Why did the eldest, the senior most people, went away soon, escaped and went away? What is the reason you think, my dear brothers and sisters? Why? Maybe because, some say, because they committed more sin. Some others say, no, they were more prudent to go away soon. Not that they committed more sin, but they were more prudent. Better we should not be caught. If we remain here, that's all. In front of the divine judgment, we are nowhere. They realized it and went away. That was what happened. That was what happened. During the season of Lent, if at all we are converted from this aspect of false judgment of others. We do not know everything. Sometimes we are too quick to judge others. Like that one, a lady from the Legion of Mary came and told the parish priest, this lady, she is of a very bad character, parish priest. Father, you have to correct her. Why? Then she said, her children are all the time playing on the streets. Sometimes some men come to her house alone, though she is a widow. There is something very bad about her. You have to correct her. They told the parish priest. Then parish priest, because of the repeated complaint of people against her, once wanted to talk with her. Come on. After the mass, he called that lady and then asked, what is the problem with you? What about your family? Then she said, she was in the last stages of her cancer. I did not want my children to see me crying, screaming, shouting. That's why I allow them to play more. Not to see my pain. Sometimes I come from the hospital, I experience acute pain. Then the parish priest asked her, it seems some men are coming to your house. Father, only the doctor comes, my family doctor, to give occasional treatment. And the other is our lawyer to set right the will, to set right the property. See, my dear brothers and sisters, how hasty the other woman was in judging this particular person. You do not know the whole of truth. Don't attribute motives to other people's actions. Only the Lord looks at your heart. By the measure you judge others, you will be judged before God. Be compassionate. Be kind in judging your family members. In dealing with others, be generous. Be generous. Be understanding to your family members. The Lord asks you only that.
And then the rest of the incident, everyone left the scene. And then the woman and Jesus alone are there. St. Augustine, commenting on this passage, very beautifully says, there were only left two things or two persons, human misery and divine mercy. Very beautiful, my dear brothers and sisters. Divine mercy is there in the form of Jesus. And then human misery, helplessness in the form of the woman. We do not know what forced her, what were her circumstances. Jesus did not say, come on, don't worry, what happened doesn't matter. No. Jesus also does not approve of her act, come what may. Jesus wanted her to be faithful in her life. What did Jesus say? Let no one condemn you. No one, sir, she says. Then neither do I condemn you. But then he gives her the instruction, do not sin anymore. Sin is very bad. It is infidelity to God. It is ingratitude to God. Do not sin anymore. How much she experienced the love of Jesus, compassion of Jesus, knowing the gravity of sin and starting a new life. My dear brothers and sisters, today's first reading tells us, think of all that the Lord has done for you in the past. Hold on to the Lord. We are called to cling to the Lord. The people of Israel were in exile in Babylon. They were helpless, hopeless. They were weeping. They were lamenting. The Lord has let us down. What will happen to us? Then the consoling message of the prophet comes. Come on, think of the past. First of all, it is I who led you from slavery to freedom. From the land of Egypt to the land of Canaan. It was I who did all the miracles. The same person. Now, I am going to do new things in your life. That's it. We are called to trust in the Lord who can give us freedom, true joy. That's how we ought to go forward. The same Lord looks at each and every one of us with love, with compassion, with understanding. The Lord looks at us every time we come to the sacrament of reconciliation. The same Lord who looked at the adulterous woman, He is looking at us. Come on, make the confession at the earliest. I'm happy that our parish priest devotes much of his time in hearing the confession of the people. Spend sufficient time to God. You are experiencing the love of Jesus like the adulterous woman. A boy got the progress card. He did not get good marks. On the way, he tells the companion, I don't know what is going to happen to me when I go show to my father. I am afraid he is going to beat me terribly. I am going to get severe beating. He is so much frightened. And as he is going, he is sharing with his companion, a little boy. He goes home, and then tomorrow there are 3 or 4 days given to bring back the progress card to the school after getting signature from the parent. Then he is afraid of facing the father. So he tells the mother, Mommy, you sign the progress. Because marks are like racks, 3, 4, 5 like that. Not rack, it is marks. So some of the children don't study properly. The mother is very wise. She says, no, your daddy will come tomorrow. He is leaving for the office. You are asking for the signature from me. He will sign. This evening he will come yours. Then he is so frightened so much. What? That evening itself mother says, look at his rank card, progress report. The father is so angry, scolds him, gives him S class. So frightened. Then he rushes to the mother only. Mother embraces him. Mother also doesn't approve of his low scores. Mother also is very sad. The mother also is very sad, very upset about what has happened to the son. He has not done well. But mother looks at the son with love, encouragement, embraces him and tells him, this time you fail, doesn't matter. Hereafter you study well and prove before your father that you can do well. My dear brothers and sisters, that's what happened. People were all watching like the classmate of that boy. What will happen? Let us see. They are unconcerned. The Pharisees are angry, like the father of the family. And Jesus is like the mother of the family, embracing the boy, telling him, come on, what you have done is not good, but the next time you can do better. That's what happens in the sacrament of reconciliation. You have failed. You did not live up to the occasion that the Lord has given to you. Come on, start a new life. My dear brothers and sisters, do not postpone the sacrament of reconciliation. At the earliest, go to Jesus, who is there waiting for you, to understand you. Pour out before Him. The Lord Jesus is going to look at you with understanding and mercy. He is not there to condemn you. He is going to say, woman, my dear son, my dear child, your sins are forgiven. Do not sin anymore. Experiencing the love of Jesus. May we not condemn others, because the Lord doesn't condemn. May we approach the Lord, who is ready to forgive, who is compassionate towards us. Amen.